Well, Alzheimer's disease is a very complex disease. We are learning more and more these days about Alzheimer's disease, but certainly it's a devastating disease of the brain that results in cognitive decline and progressive cognitive decline and affects people at different ages, but notably about quite a considerable number of people over age of 65 and older. Results in loss of memory, loss of learning capabilities, and numerous behavioral changes in the personality. So, and ends up that the person eventually at the end of the game, at the end of the disease, is absolutely unable to perform normal functions of the brain and eventually dies. I'm very much interested into the roots of Alzheimer's disease, ALS, and stroke, and to understand the pathogenesis of these diseases as a possibility to develop new treatments for these diseases. The brain vascular system plays one of the very important roles for brain function. The capillary networks, which are wonderfully organized, parallel all major brain circuits that are tasked with sensation, motor function, memory, and many other functions. The brain vascular network expands to about 400 miles in length, and it is like from Los Angeles to San Francisco. It's a really huge, huge capillary tube that needs to remain perfectly intact for the brain functions to remain intact. And you can imagine, let's say 1 mile of the vascular tube is incorrect, and if it is in the wrong position in the brain, that can lead to tremendous pathologies. Maybe if it is in hippocampus, it can lead to memory loss and loss of learning, such as in Alzheimer's disease. Capillaries needs to be fully intact in brain because they regulate two-way traffic between systemic circulation or brain circulation and inside in the brain. The neurovascular unit is a newly coined term to describe that in the brain, in addition to neurons, other cells which are part of the neurovascular unit, such as brain endothelial cells, pericytes, vascular smooth muscle cells, astrocytes, and other glial cell types, play an important role in normal brain functions and in disease. And so what we're trying to understand with this concept of neurovascular unit is how these different cell types talk between each other and how the disrupted talk between, let's say, endothelial cells and pericytes or astrocytes and pericytes, just to take an example, can actually lead to injury and damage of neurons. We must have a perfect harmony between other cell types in order for brain circuits to function properly. So that actually emphasizes the role of vascular system and particularly the structure of the blood-brain barrier. If we talk about the anatomical blood-brain barrier that is composed of endothelial cells that form a tight junction zipped endothelial membrane that is continuous in the brain. If you remember, all these 400 miles have to be paved by endothelium. The blood-brain barrier is structured in brain that controls trafficking of molecules from blood into the brain and from brain into the blood. So it selectively allows some molecules that are important for brain metabolism to come from blood into the brain, such as sugar, glucose, amino acids, or oxygen. But in the same time, prevents entry of cells that would cause inflammation in the brain, or red blood cells that will cause deposition of iron or hemoglobin that are all toxic for brain cells. So it does this dual function. In addition to that, from the brain side, the blood-brain barrier promotes clearance and elimination and removal of potentially toxic products from brain back into the systemic circulation. For example, during normal brain functions, Alzheimer's toxin, amyloid beta, accumulates in brain and needs to be removed. And we discovered the molecular clearance mechanisms in brain capillaries which mediate this removal, which is an important therapeutic target. So we can say the blood-brain barrier is a gatekeeper of the brain, and pericytes are a gatekeeper of the blood-brain barrier. Pericytes, in terms of being gatekeeper of the blood-brain barrier, regulate physical properties by which endothelial cells communicate with each other. And they are typically actually connected by tight junctions, which do not allow transport of molecules between brain and blood. The pericytes are vital integrators of the blood-brain barrier functions. We need to understand molecular pathways that actually regulate crosstalk between pericytes and endothelial cells of the blood-brain barrier. Also, pericytes reduce what we call vesicular non-specific transport of fluid across the endothelial cells. When pericytes are degenerating, this transport of fluid happens, and a lot of toxins can convert this fluid across the endothelial cells into the brain. And neurons, the cells that actually form brain circuits, do not like any changes of the environment. The environment has to be kept very stable and very constant in terms of electrolytes, in terms of sugars, in terms of amino acid concentration, all others, and is very tightly controlled. In Alzheimer's disease, it has been shown that patients have numerous microhemorrhages in brain. In addition to that, you know, postmortem studies, pathological studies, have shown completely blood-brain barrier breakdown and reduction of population in pericytes. So therefore, we believe that the intact blood-brain barrier in Alzheimer's disease is very important. But the breakdown of the blood-brain barrier happens in Alzheimer's disease and allows influx of toxic products into the brain. Well, we hope that the research that we are doing will contribute to development of new treatments and also an early diagnostics of Alzheimer's disease.